about day two, like how to update it during runtime. And of course, as development knows all the details about the implementation, they certainly are part of the support of the application. IT operations, on the other hand, has a more holistic view on the whole infrastructure, like the whole performance. A strong concern is the security of the full stack, not just application or just infrastructure, and also availability, and not just of that single application, but of the whole portfolio of applications. So what we can see, that's quite different perspectives, basically on the same stack. And here, a service mesh can really give you a single glass of pane on that stack, what's happening during runtime. So you can have an easier way to collaborate and troubleshoot errors. We now want to go through a few use cases, what service mesh can help you with. But first, I want to show you why it's just now so necessary. In the past, most applications were built monolithic and grew and grew and grew. So now they're really hard to handle. In the meantime, more and more applications were built up from the very beginning in a distributed way, like microservices we heard from Timo Zahn before. And also microservices already around for quite a few years. And one of the stack that offered a very nice quick start into building microservices was the Spring Boot Netflix stack, or Spring Cloud Netflix stack. It had libraries for all the patterns you want to introduce in a distributed system, like service discovery. If you have multiple instances, you want to be able to connect those different services and instances. And of course, you also want to secure them, secure the access to them. The challenge here is, as fast as it is with building, on day two, if you have to maintain the application, you mix up your domain business logic with technical concerns. And so the application is in production. Each time there's a change for any of those dependencies, you have to update the application as a whole, rerun all tests, do all the staging, and again, deploy it. Not just when you change any of your business logic, but really if there's any technical change. And that's where the service mesh really shines. So if we're talking about service mesh, it's Istio. So it's completely Istio based. And we now go through a few of the general service mesh use cases. In the end, I will give a quick summary what's special about Tanzu service mesh. And we see it here on the picture. We have a clear separation now of the app container that contains the business logic for the what the application wants to solve. On the other hand, Istio injects automatically a sidecar container. So your Kubernetes deployment in the pod, there's another container that handles the connectivity between the services you deploy. It does the service discovery. And now we want to dive a bit deeper into how it solves this. So me as a developer, I wrote a nice little application. That's one of the typical three-tier applications, so not really microservices based, but for simplicity, it's still distributed anyway. There's network traffic between them. So that should quite well work for the showcase here. So we have a web front end that's served by Nginx server that's connected to a backend that has a REST interface to serve the data and talks itself again to a MySQL database, which contains the state. Of course, we have a Kubernetes ingress at the front to guide in traffic. And as a developer, also took an eye on security. Of course, there is authentication for the user when his requests get in. Of course, the database is secured via password, so only the backend has the password to access the database, so there's no direct traffic from the web front end database. So, well, there we ready to go, aren't we, Daniel?
So, but is it really enough security to have only a password? So let me start with a fairy tale from Red Riding Hood. So in this case, I hope you know the story. So the wolf pretends to be Red Riding Hood in the beginning, and grandma must believe that the wolf is Red Riding Hood. So grandma let Red Riding Hood in, and the wolf eats grandma. A little bit later, Red Riding Hood comes to the house and asks the wolf, "Hey, grandma, why do you have so big eyes?" and so on. And the wolf pretends to be the grandma. And after a short while, the wolf also eats the Red Riding Hood. So because there was no other person in the room that can grant that grandma is grandma or Red Riding Hood is Red Riding Hood. So, and this is what we have also in the IT a lot of times. So how can I be sure that the server is the real server that I want to connect, or that the other side is allowed to connect to the server? The good thing in this story is, in the end, everything was good because there comes a huntman, and the huntman frees both Red Riding Hood and grandma. So unfortunately, in the real world, in the real IT world, there is no huntman who can solve your issues. So you must take care about the application. And as Andres have mentioned before, the developer writes the code, gives it to the operations team, and the operations team is responsible for the whole application. Another thing, what if you have your application not on one server, if you have your application on different servers, or maybe you have one part of the application running on your private data center, the other part of the application running in a public cloud? How can you be sure that your connection between the servers is encrypted? So maybe the developer uses some applications that are not able to encrypt. So this is another problem that we see in some environments. And maybe you would like to have policy that allows someone in, maybe the authenticated person, and other persons are not allowed to go in. So who can you be sure that you have access to people that are allowed to have access? Andreas mentions the Chinese wall in the beginning. And this is also one problem. So if you are behind the wall, how can you see everything that's on the other side? So how can you give control to the systems if you do not see anything? And there's tons of service mesh coming into play, where you have the option to see everything because you have, So these are the problems we see. And this service mesh, Andreas also mentioned it before, you put a container or a sidecar proxy in each pod. So every traffic that goes out from your container goes first to the proxy, and the proxy decides where to go to. With this option, you have the option to enable mutual TLS. So there's a trust point between both containers. So not only in the receiver direction, also in the sender direction. You have encrypted traffic on the complete application. So it doesn't matter if the services run on the same host or if they are running on different hosts. So you cannot hijack the traffic. Or if you hijack the traffic, you see only encrypted data. And this is what we can enable with service mesh. So the only thing that needs to be changed, you see it here, we set a label on the namespace issue injection is enabled. And with this option, automatically the container issue proxy will be deployed with each container. And what you need also to do is you need to create a virtual service beside the normal service to get all the information about the deployments and so on. And for the outgoing connection, you have an Istio gateway as front end, and the Istio gateway gives you access to the systems. This gives you, of course, a full visibility on your whole environment, because now you can see each packet that leaves a container. And now you can see how many requests per second coming into your system, what is the latency from the container, and if you have failures, you will also see the failure rate, so how many of your requests are not working properly. In this showcase, you see there's application, the shopping app. It's where you can buy some things. And the half of the containers running in one cluster, the other half of the containers running in another cluster. Because of Service Mesh or Tanzu Service Mesh, you can enable a global namespace so that you can combine more than one cluster to one cluster, and you can run the services across different data centers. So maybe one part in AWS, the other part on-prem. Here's a complete demo app. You see, I have created a load generator. I simulate 600 users, and the 600 users go to the shopping front end, and from the shopping front end, they put some things in the cart, they do an order, and in the end, they do a payment. So this is what you will see in the next demo. So the demo is recorded. I've done this yesterday. So I will start now with the demo. Here you see the front end from the shopping app. You can browse through the catalog, can choose the items, put it in the cart, and order this. And I have a second app running. This is a locust app, and I simulate the 600 users. I have round about 150 requests per second. And you see also the failure rate. So in the moment, I've overloaded my system and see there are a lot of failures. And now I will jump to the Tanzu Service Mesh. And this is a entry from the Tanzu Service Mesh web page. And here you can see the different global namespaces you've created. And inside the application, you can see the shopping app. You see the real requests per second, the latency, and also the error rate. So you have the full visibility about your application, not only a part, it's end to end. You can go in more detail, check each container. So you see the application is good or bad. In the moment it's yellow, so it's not so good. You have latencies, you have the error rate. So this is what you get with Tanzu Service Mesh. And you can also check the different clusters in your environment. And you have the node heat map, so you can see the latency to each container. You can also say, let's check the CPU usage from each container or the disk usage. So in addition to this, you have also other things you can do. You can integrate your domain names. You can also create the CA certificates and insert your certificates to all the containers. And you have an easy software upgrade option here. So because you do not need to take care about dependencies from different versions, and you have the option, if there's something going wrong, you have the rollback button to go back to the last stable version. Oops, sorry. So now let's go to different use cases.
Okay, thank you, Daniel. So, and service mesh is not just about troubleshooting. That was the main use case, I would say, we talked about now. If you listen to the keynote from Mike Cote in the morning, you saw driving innovation is a lot about experimenting. And what do children want more than more candy, even more candy? And so what gives them more candy? Is it the pirate or is it the ghost? And that's the same you can translate to our web shop. Like, do we have, for example, really only bike enthusiasts that when they buy a bike, they want to have another bike? Or should you present them, if they have a bike, also a home trainer for winter season? Or is it more like people who buy a bike also like climbing equipment because they like they are more the generalist in sports? To find it out, you can point them to different versions of your shop, take metrics, and then decide really from a business perspective what matters. And if you translate that to our little application, we can see we have an one more object. Like we have still our interests, we still have our shopping, and we now extend it. The virtual service was mentioned by Daniel, is the object, and we have now a destination rule. And of course, we have two kinds of actual deployments of our shopping service. Now, that's just the basic Kubernetes labels, the service points via selector to labels of an app that's shopping, the service is also shopping, and we extend it by saying there are now two versions. And now we have to tell Istio, well, there is subsets. They, of course, have a name, and we have a pointer, again, via label to the specific version. And on top of that, we have to tell the virtual service that there is now not just one destination, but we have two destinations. We also have to give it the port number it can reach them under. And then we do weighted routing here. So we tell how much of the traffic is going to one for the version one and how much is going to version two. So we took here one of the simpler options. Of course, you could also involve quite some logic on the application level, how you handle it. So that's the simple entry on a pure networking level. And Daniel will now show us in the demo how that looks like.
So it's again our shopping app. And you can see if I press the refresh button, it's always the same page. And you see I have in the moment only one instance running this shopping app. Now let's go to the virtual service. And inside the virtual service, you see the gateway, so my ingress gateway. You see host name, so this name is the application listened to. And you see the host, so the host name is a service as a pointer, so where the application can be found. So now first I will check my service, and what Andreas mentioned before, there's a selector, and the selector maps on app shopping and service shopping. So let's find out how many pods we have up and running. So in the moment, we have only the one pod that is up and running. And now I go to the destination rule. This is what you see in the picture before. I have two versions, one version with shopping V1 and the other one with shopping V2. I copy the name. And let's search for pods with also version shopping V1. I see there's one pod up and running. But if I make the same for V2, there's no pod. Now I create a second deployment with version V2. And in the deployment, I change the color from the front end to gray and give the, of course, the name shopping V2. If I search now for the application or the pod, I can see there's a container up and running. If I go now to refresh, you see sometimes I have a gray background, sometimes I have the white background. So this is a normal behavior if you have more than one deployment and you do not have any rules that point to specific versions. So in my front, I see there are two deployments right now under the service shopping. And now I will go to my virtual service. First, I copy the name so that I do not make any typos. And now I add some lines to my existing virtual service. So this is a subset. And the second one I need to do is to set the weight. In this case, say, okay, let's start with 100% to see that it's working fine. And create a second one, the destination rules shopping V2. And now I will only land on the page with a white front end. So if I go now to my performance graph on shopping V2, you see there are coming some requests in because I set now the value to 0. So no request should come to the shopping V2. You see after a minute that the traffic decreases. And if I go to shopping V1, this is the one with 100%. You see the same in the other direction. So the requests increase. And now I will change only the values to 90 and 10. So it means 10% of all users will now get access to shopping V2 and the other 90% will get access to shopping V1. And this is what you see here. There's a little bit of traffic going to shopping V2. So if you find out that everything is working fine, we can say, okay, let's move from shopping V1 completely to shopping V2. And again, after some time, you will see that all the requests going only to shopping V2 and vice versa on shopping V1, the traffic stops completely. So this is one of the functions that you get also with tons of service mesh beside the security functions. One other thing you may have in mind, what's with your scaling strategy? So there are different scaling strategies you can have. Maybe you say, okay, I'm more the proactive scaling strategist. So buy everything you can get and have enough resources available all the time. So this is working good. So, but this wastes also a lot of resources because you have all the time a lot of machines up and running, also if you do not need them. So, and also if you did not calculate it right, it could be that the proactive solution became reactive because there's end of your resources and then you are lost again. So reactive is more common for testing environments where you can say, okay, it does not matter if the request takes too long. So if you have a real environment, if you, yeah, maybe you have the shopping environment, you have a shop and users cannot get the resources or cannot get the information just in time, they will go to another store. So this is a problem with reactive. So the good thing is there's also a predictive way so that you say, okay, you should have at least a little bit more resources than needed in the moment, but you must have also the option to scale up and scale down. And there comes a problem with Kubernetes or with standard Kubernetes. If it's only CPU based, then you may not have enough information available to scale your deployment in the right manner. So with Tanzu Service Mesh, you have also the option to say, okay, let's do the scaling based on requests per seconds because you know your application has problems if the requests become too much, or maybe you have latency problems before the CPU stacks, then you should use latency to be sure that your application is up and running all the time. With Tanzu Service Mesh, you can define these values as an SLA. And here you can define how many, so the request number and so on. So when should the system scale up? When should the system scale down? Efficiency means that the deployment will also scale down if the resources are not longer used. I have done this with requests for my shopping and for the order. I said, okay, let's check the P90 latency. So it means 90% of all requests must be under 175 milliseconds. If it's increase the number 175, then the system will automatically deploy new containers. So here again, my app. And if I go to performance, I can see there are round about 60 requests per seconds. And now let's get my pods. So I see in the moment I have only one pod for each service. And I create now my destination or my new definition for autoscaling. Set the service and create the mode efficiency so that I say, okay, if the resources are no longer needed, then scale down. And set the requests that should be used. So what you can see now that took a while that the application get all the information, and I see currently there's one pod deployed and desired are two. So it means after a short while, the second container will be started to achieve the values I set before. So now I see, oh, two are not enough. So I need three. So increases the number again. So now you should see, I do the same with the order. With the order, I said, okay, let's go to the latency. Point to the service and change the name to P90 latency. And now I see I have two definitions defined. And it should stay stable because there are no latency, or there are no latency problems in the moment. And I see it became stable with two pods for shopping and one pod for latency. Now I increase the number of requests. So I go to 600 users. So in the moment I'm running only with 250. And now after a while, you will see requests per seconds increases and the number of pods that are desired increase also. And you can see it in the Tanzu service mesh overview that the number of pods going up. So I also get the warnings of the error here that in the moment there are problems. So because not all the pods are up right now. So, but after a while, if all the pods are up and running, the system have all the resources that's needed. So now I, for some reason, maybe in the night, some requests goes down. And so the number of pods that needs to be run can also decrease so that you have more resources available maybe for other systems. And you see the time runs a little bit faster. And this is the reason that I made the video. And this is what you can achieve also with tons of service mesh. And this is in the moment one of the unique features that you get with Tanzu.
Okay, so I hope you got a good overview of some of the use cases. For sure, they are not all. But for Tanzu service mesh, you really have to think about it's a global control plane to get visibility in all your applications during runtime. If you're interested more into cross-cluster usage of service mesh, so basically having an application that spans across two clusters, then I highly can recommend you to join Matthias Ewald's session. That's not the next, but the one after. He will highlight that. And what to say about Tanzu service mesh more? Daniel briefly mentioned it. It's not just running Istio as a service mesh on one cluster or one infrastructure. It's really scaling it up and running it potentially over hundreds of different clusters, wherever your company decides to, they need Kubernetes and want to deploy a service mesh. And it's able to lifecycle all those Istio deployments. So you don't have to spend your valuable time on maintaining infrastructure, but really to provide value to the business. And now I want to conclude with spinning a loop back to our initial question, like, can we break open all the silos? Probably not, as we learned, it's much more culture than any technology. But is it the right tool in such a culture to support to collaboration between different roles and perspectives on IT and software? For sure. For development, it means velocity. They can focus on implementing business logic and not spending their time on infrastructure or technical patterns for distributed applications. For operations, they can assure they have consistent environments over the borders of clusters and infrastructures, and also to have a common plane to troubleshoot together. For security, of course, it's the way to go, secure by default. No more arguing, do you need encryption at transport? That's automatically solved. And with that, we want to conclude for today and look in the chat if there are still any open questions we can answer live. Okay. How does service mesh and Wavefront interact to monitor performance? That's a fairly good question. They both have basically a different perspective on the same application or the same environment. Service mesh really focuses on networking at runtime, so the distributed nature of the applications. Wavefront is much more the whole observability. It concludes much more data and offers you to have much more custom dashboard, not just for technical monitoring, but also probably for more business or domain related questions. So it's basically tools for different jobs. That's how I would separate them. And we have another question. Is there a Tanzu training course from MyLearn that covers the service mesh topic?
So I'm not sure if there's anything. Of course you can request a demo. You can also make a proof of technology in your house, in your environment to test Tanzu service mesh.
Okay, now that's an interesting question.
How service mesh is different from Mesh 7? So you hear that we acquired Mesh 7 a few months ago, and in the moment we are starting to integrate Mesh 7 also in Tanzu service mesh. So Patrick Steiner answered this question this morning also. So in the moment, yeah, it's in the planning phase or in the integration phase. So we can give you answers later, so not today. And if you are interested, we can also give you contact from the product management team, so to get more details into Mesh 7.
Right.
Okay. Guess that we're all questioned. With that being said, thank you for attending and back to Matthias.